This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do.
Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Thanks for listening to the ungated version of the Unsupervised Learning podcast. If you want to read some essays on some of these topics, please check out razib.substack.com. Again, that's razib.substack.com. Thank you.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib Khan with the Unsupervised Learning podcast. And I'm here with my friend John Hawks, Dr. John Hawks of University of Wisconsin, also the co-author with Lee Berger of Almost Human, The Astonishing Tale of Homo naledi and the Discovery That Changed Our Human Story, and one of the most, eminent paleoanthropology bloggers. We talked about your blogging career along with your academic career and all those things in a previous podcast, John. So, for the listeners who are new, and they will be very new because I think the last time we talked was almost 2 years ago.
That's amazing. People keep asking, why aren't I on Razib's show? And I was like, dude, I was on well before you started.
Yes. So people actually say things like that. You should have so-and-so on. Yeah. So there's this thing called archives. And so if you click next, anyway, in any case, although maybe we should surface some of that. I uploaded, as some of you know, some of you who are watching this potentially, I've started uploading things onto YouTube as well. So, you get really granular download data there. So, just kind of seeing what you guys like. And what you guys really like is paleoanthropology, which, as John knows, and I think the listeners know, that's not really my bread and butter. I'm super into it. But I don't look at a bunch of bones, and I can't intuitively kind of grok things, you know. And I think John can. He's one of those people that can. I think most of us could tell a naledi from a naledi Denisovan / Neanderthal from a maybe modern skull, but that's probably the extent of it. I want to ask. So you wrote a book about naledi a while ago now. Evolution time in this century, it's really a while ago. And I know you guys are working at the cave site in South Africa, discovering a lot of new things. I'm just kind of like, let's not beat around the bush. Like, what's going on with fire? Lee came out with this finding, and it took the interwebs by storm. So, Naledi's got a small brain. What's going on? Like, fire, really? Like, so, like, tell me about it, John.
This is a fascinating, really fascinating time for us. COVID had made a tremendous difference for most people who have field work in archaeology, anthropology. We've had people who are doing work globally who have not been able to be effectively at their field sites, sometimes for 2 or 3 years. It's still, I think, for a lot of people, taking time to get back to where they've caught up to where they were. For our team, really fortunately, because of Lee's, residence presence in South Africa, and because of our team on the ground in South Africa, we didn't have the same kind of interruption and delay in terms of field work. But we've got a lot of other stuff going on in the field. And in fact, most of the team's efforts were directed toward other sites. Rising Star has a number of challenges for us in terms of working underground. It is a site that has really narrow, constricting passages. It's one where there's a huge logistical sort of a need for us to put into place a lot of things to be able to work underground. That's a unique challenge, in terms of field work. So we actually weren't working in Rising Star during the pandemic at all. And we returned to Rising Star for field work during this year, during 2022, have some really, really fascinating stuff. And so, I can give maybe the thing to do is to give sort of where we were in 2018 and what is going on, what's happened since then in broad strokes and what we're interested in right now.
Do it. Be our Sherpa.
So where we were in 2018, we had come off the discovery of this enormous trove of fossil hominins inside of this very deep chamber, the deep chamber, the Naledi chamber, It is about 150 meters from the surface. It's at least 30 to 40 meters underground, under the ground surface today. And it is accessed by us only through a very narrow passageway that's about a 40-foot descent that is super challenging, that most people cannot go through. You have to have a pretty good climbing background, and you have to be pretty skinny. The minimum point in this is a 7.5-inch squeeze. And so you have to fit through that in order to get into this chamber. It is a squeeze.
I just did with my hands. That's tiny. That's yeah. tiny. You got, yeah. you got to recruit some hobbits, you know?
Yeah. This is a really, really weird, you know, sort of scenario for us to find. Right now, our number of fossils from this part of the cave system is about 2,500. It is, you know, they're mostly fragments. You know, we're looking right now at what is a minimum of, I think, 25 individuals in this part of the cave system. So there's a bunch of skeletons in there, and we are only really scratching the surface of it in terms of our excavations to date. We have dug an area that is in this part of the cave system less than 2.5 square meters in total size. So really not very deeply. So we're, you know, there's potentially a lot more there that we haven't, you know, uncovered. By 2018, we had also uncovered fossils in a second part of the cave system that we call the naledi chamber, which is very far from the first, also in a really narrow and hard to get to part of the cave, also super far underground and super dark, but not anywhere near the first bit. So finding these fossils in two very widespread parts of the cave system, in the naledi chamber, including a partial skeleton of an individual that was really well preserved. We named this the Neo skeleton, the same species as the first, Homo naledi, and really anatomically very similar, directed our attention to the reality that we're looking at a species that is using this cave system. They can get into dark parts of the cave. These are their spaces in some way. So that we knew by, you know, we published that material in 2017. We also at that time had published the geological age of these fossils. They, in the Denisovans chamber, date to between 241,000 and 236,000 years ago. So these fossils are coeval. They lived at the same time with early members of Homo sapiens, our species. Early members of Homo sapiens found in many parts of Africa, we think. Homo naledi found so far in this part of Africa. They're potentially on the same landscapes, and we're super interested in how this is possible. This species, Homo naledi, is human-like in a few ways. It's got human-like feet and legs. It walks pretty much like us. It's got human-like hands, actually. It handles things like us. Its teeth are not, its teeth are functionally like ours. They're little compared to their body size, and they seem to have eaten a high-quality diet. But teeth are markers of evolution, and these teeth look pretty much like early members of our genus, like Homo habilis or something that lived 2 million years ago. They just are human function compared to those. But the brain of Homo naledi is between 450 and 600 cubic centimeters. It's about a third the size of human brains today, about a third the size of early human brains, right? They're outliers in relation to the other hominins in their environment, which is, you know, our species, Homo sapiens, and potentially an archaic form of humans, manifested by the skull from Kabwe, Zambia, and some other parts of Africa, but in particular that Kabwe skull, about 300,000 years old, also potentially in this same time range with these species. So Africa is a crowded place, and we're working to understand the place of this one species in it, and that's where we were in 2018. We continued after that stage to investigate what we could about how naledi was using this cave system, right? we dug a little more in the naledi chamber and in an adjacent area called the hill antechamber and excavated some more fossil material from there. Our teams did exploration of some very difficult to access parts of the cave and found some additional naledi fossils in some of these areas. We published one of those significant fossils, a partial juvenile skull from a very, very narrow passage in 2021. And we, you know, have been broadly working to understand, is naledi using these parts of the cave system as a mortuary space? What kind of evidence can we acquire to understand their behavior in the cave system? And what evidence can we develop about naledi's environment? Because the thing that we don't have in any of these spaces is other stuff from their landscape, you know, other animals that they might have been living with or eating or living at the same time as, right? We're really finding bones of naledi and not anything else that's associated with them. So that's where we had been and what we had been working on. This year, we opened excavation in a new part of the cave system called the Dragon's Back Chamber. And that is near the naledi chamber and part of the cave. It's the area, Dragon's Back, that you actually have to climb up onto to get down into the very narrow passage that goes into the naledi chamber. So Dragon's Back is like the next area. It's like the staging area. And for us, it was a really logical place to think of looking for evidence of naledi's use of the cave system. We do have fossil material in Dragon's Back in brecciated contexts. We've been pretty open about that. What we were investigating this year was the floor of the chamber to see if we had potentially evidence of naledi behavior, you know, that archaeology, in other words, in the floor. I can report, Ali's, you know, been really open about it, that we did find charcoal in that context and burned animal bone. And as we found that, Lee actually went to the effort of, during this year, losing about 50 kilos, 50 pounds, I should say, 55 pounds now, so like 25 kilos, to make it possible for himself to climb down into the super narrow.
Are you serious?
I'm serious, yes.
I've met Lee, guys. He's not a massive dude in the first place. This is not the biggest loser. Like, he says, like, you know, let's just say he's probably smaller than the average American man his size. I'll put it that way, I would say. Like, what that I saw.
He was certainly not, you know, not obese or by any means really large, you know. And he did, you know, he's become very fit.
He got shredded for science.
Yeah, absolutely. It is, I mean, you know, I admire the guy for a lot of reasons, but his commitment to exploration is, I think, beyond what you can see in most people who are scientists. You know, Lee is putting it all on the table to try to understand, right, this space and the species that lived in the space. We have, you know, he made significant discoveries in that context. And what he's talking about is the, you know, the observation that we may have soot on the ceiling of the naledi chamber. He also has reported that we have evidence of charcoal in some other parts of the cave system. One of those is an area that we hadn't investigated before. And so this is a new area for us. So that's what's going on with that. You know, we have evidence of fire in parts of the cave where previously we've only had evidence of naledi's activity. And so that's a spatial association that we have between charcoal, fire, burned animal bones, and naledi bones. What we don't have yet is a really good chronological understanding of the fire. We don't know, you know, if it's associated with naledi, it's not going to be radiocarbon age. And so that, you know, creates for us some challenges in interpreting what we're finding and contextualizing it. And that lies in front of us. You know, right now we're super interested in this because we're working on the deep cave use by an extinct species of hominins. People naturally ask, are they lighting their way in the cave? Are they have fire? There's no surprise, really, that there should be fire in this context. We have fire in human origins that's more than a million years old. So finding fire 250,000 years ago would not be a huge story. But finding fire in this context, I think, does give us, you know, some assurance that we're actually going to understand the use of this cave by this species. You know, we're getting more than just their bones now. We're getting now other kinds of evidence. And that's going to lead us into a path where we're looking at a culture as opposed to looking at bones. And for us, that's very exciting.
Yeah, let's, I've done a podcast with you before, John, actually several, back the previous podcast that I have, The Insight. I had a really long conversation with Spencer Wells and Lee. And, just for the listener and the viewers, I actually found out about naledi. I don't know if he named it naledi. In 2013, when I was at the National Geographic offices, just visiting, I got to sit in. And the weird thing was, it was freaky because there's all this data, all of these bones. And, you know, okay, how do the bones get there? This is a small-brained hominin. Like, how do they wash down there? Well, the other option is they went down there. Well, there's no other animals. Like, what's going on here? Why would you go down there? They're not like troglodytes. They can't really live down there, can they? It came up like ritual, like some sort of human cultural thing is going on, these small brain hominins. And the fire makes sense. I think fire is probably pretty ancient in our lineage, you know? But I guess the question here is, and this is kind of a question related to the hobbits, of Flores, and now there's like Luzon hominin. Is culture just not that dependent on brain size then? Because these are very small brain hominins. But, it's starting to get hard to explain unless you do divine or alien intervention of what's going on here, right?
I think that we've been thinking about culture all wrong. You know, I think that, you know, and to be honest, I'm equally guilty as anybody, right? Before 2010, I'm probably thinking, you know, culture really relies on having large brains. We're using these for language. We're using them to have ginormous lexicons that let us share information between individuals. We're using them to track social relationships and kinship in really complicated ways, right? That's what brains are for, is anthropology textbook circa 2010. And what we are dealing with today is very small-brained species that have persisted into the relatively recent paleontological record alongside the very large-brained Homo sapiens-type lineage, which includes Neanderthals and Denisovans, whatever they, you know, actually looked like. They, all of us think they had big brains. and for that matter, late Homo erectus, right? This is a lineage that went down a path of increasing brain size, and other lineages didn't, and they did fine. You know, I think really that's the naledi discovery, is that you don't persist in Africa alongside of, you know, a lineage that's rapidly increasing brain size unless you've got something going on, you know, that cognitively that enables you to compete effectively in the same landscape. With Floresiensis, you could always argue that they're on an island. They're isolated. You cannot maintain that for naledi. You can't, for that matter, maintain it for Paranthropus, right? We have Robustus that's persisting until after a million years ago, right, in an African landscape with very large brain hominins, you know, that maybe have double its brain size by that stage. Our journey as a species is one possibility among a spectrum that our near relatives followed. And we have been acting like, for most of our field's history, the spectrum is determined by what's happening with brain size and behavior. And I think that what we're discovering is that behavior is diverse and manifested in different lineages in really interesting ways, and that one of these lineages did something really different with brain size, but that one thing that it did was not the bread and butter of survival and culture and even hunting and gathering, but was something different. And what that was, I think right now, is one of the great mysteries of certainly my field of science, right? What difference do big brains make? I think that's a super question right now.
Well, but the encephalization, so you're talking about encephalization of our lineage, quote unquote, because our lineage is diverse and now we see that the encephalization didn't happen everywhere. That's what you're alluding to here. The brain didn't get continuously larger in some branches like the hobbits and like the naledi here. Continued until about 200,000 years ago or so. And it seems to have occurred also with Neanderthals and Denisovans. Like they had big brain cases too. So whatever was going on, it was happening all over the world, and it was driving everybody at the same time, or approximately, right? And as we famously know, some of the biggest craniums in the world are Neanderthal craniums. I'm assuming Denisovan, if we had, I pretty much would be like zero surprised if we had a lot of Denisovan crania, that they would have. I mean, what do you think? That they would have a lot of CC?
You know, I think that if you were putting money on this right now, the money is that the Harbin cranium and this Dali cranium from China, right, this sort of late archaic Chinese crania are probably Denisovan crania, and probably late Erectus in Java, like from Nandong and Sembung Makan, these sort of, Nandong is 107 to 112,000 years old, and we have historically classified it as Erectus because it's got some traits that are shared by earlier Erectus skulls. I would not be surprised if these were also Denisovan skulls. Uh-huh. That's what I am imagining these probably would have looked like. They would have been comparable to Neanderthals in cranial size. Without any question.
Yeah, let's step back here and like just set it for the, this is where if this was a essay, you would have a chart with a graph with some time points. And so the reason I'm talking about Denisovans and Neanderthals together with John is that they are sister lineages and we are the outgroup. So we're the cousin lineage. And all of us seem to have diversified the Denisovans split from us somewhere between, depending on how you estimate the molecular clock, maybe 500,000 to a million years, probably kind of in the middle time point, 600, 750, something like that. And they seem to have left Africa and diversified in Eurasia, split on the order of 500,000 years ago, 400,000 years ago. And then I want to note, and I've asked multiple people whether this is legit. It seems like legit. Denisovans, unlike Neanderthals, seem to have really, really deep lineages. And we know this because Denisovan DNA is found throughout Eastern Eurasia. And it's very different. The whole genomes that we have are from Denisovan Cave, obviously, in Siberia. But, there's Denisovan ancestry in Papua, in Southeast Asia, in India, in China. The one in China is much more like the Altai, Denisovan, Denisova Denisovan. Whereas the ones elsewhere are very, very different. So, that's just to set the context here. So now we've been talking about naledi for a while. Like, let's go to Neanderthals, which is, look, with all due respect to Svante, you were, in my opinion, the original Neanderthal man of the internet blogosphere of the 2000s. Let's talk about Neanderthals. Since the last time I talked to you, do we know much more? Like, I feel like the main thing, and I look at it from a genetics perspective, the main thing that I am aware of now is like, okay, like we have a little better grasp of what donor Neanderthal population contributed to modern humans. It's something closer to Vendesia as opposed to the Altai ones. And it also looks like there's weird issues related to reciprocal gene flow between Neanderthals and humans, especially with the uniparental lineages. And David Reich just straight up said, maybe we're just wrong about everything because it's kind of weird. You want to talk about the Neanderthal uniparental and the whole genome and the weird issues going on here?
I think it's fascinating. I think, I pay attention and interact a lot with folks who study primates and hybridization in primates. And I'm always struck when you see these similarities where what we're seeing in these ancient hominins is actually got models in baboons or models in howler monkeys, or models in other kinds of primates that are mixing, that are hybridizing, right? And one of the really fascinating and substantial ones is what's going on with the Neanderthals. Neanderthals, we recognize historically on the basis of their anatomy. And it didn't have to turn out this way, but it did. And it's interesting that it turned out this way, that the genetics that we get out of fossils actually kind of confirm that this is a group. It didn't have to turn out that way, right? It could have been that actually we were all wrong. There were all these different lineages and they were deeply diverged and we were just recognizing skulls and it didn't have any real basis in reality. The Neanderthals is a case where basically the earliest parts of the European lineage that leads to them, the Cima de los Huesos fossils in Spain from about 430,000 years ago, have DNA sequence that looks like it should be an early member of a Neanderthal lineage. And they have a few cranial traits that look like early Neanderthals. And so it's like, wow, this kind of works. And then you've got later Neanderthals that successively get more and more Neanderthal looking, right? There's this trajectory and they have various cranial and postcranial traits that become more common over time. Their population, their sample becomes more recognizably different from today's modern humans. And it all kind of makes sense. Except that we now know that this lineage has interesting genetic replacements. They get halfway through their existence a new mitochondrial branch that came from Africa. And so the old mitochondria are just gone and they get these new mitochondria. And the same thing happens with the Y chromosome, right? Their old Y chromosome, gone. They get this African Y chromosome. And depending on how you look right now, it looks like maybe 10% of their nuclear genome does the same kind of thing. Like the Neanderthals that existed 100,000 years ago are kind of like 10% African. And they got mitochondria Y chromosome lineages totally that their, you know, European ancestors hadn't had. So that's pretty cool, right? That's telling us that hybridization, gene flow across these big spaces in very sparse populations made a big difference to their evolution. You know, that it's measurable. So that's pretty cool. I like that. It is interesting in that vein that we don't have much evidence at all of the reverse direction. It's interesting we don't have Neanderthal stuff that was getting into Africa at an early phase, or Denisovan stuff for that matter, getting into Africa at an early phase. We just don't have a lot of evidence for it. It's also interesting where we have genetic samples of Denisovans and Neanderthals, which is Central Asia, where we have actual hybrids, the bones of at least one individual that has a Neanderthal mother and a Denisovan father, right? That's like so weird. But that the long distance effects of this are basically nil. We do not see, you know, substantial Denisovan input into the Neanderthal populations in Europe that we can find, right? There's something interesting about the fact that it's the modern lineage where the introgressions are making a big difference to the Neanderthals. And maybe that's functional. Maybe it's that, you know, this is a great big African diverse population and there's useful stuff that is making headway into the Neanderthal population where it could. It may be that we'll find that also happened across Southern Asia, you know, eventually if we get good genetic samples of it. You know, we are at the mercy of the samples. And at the moment, the samples are so overrepresented in the northernmost parts of Eurasia, where most of the action is certainly along the southern tier of Eurasia, I would think.
Yeah. I mean, just to flesh it out a little bit as well, or add like one little branch, because this is kind of like a big tree, a bramble. I've talked to people about this. There's not that much evidence. There's a few papers out there, but they're very poorly. Let's just say there's not strong consensus behind them of like two waves of modern humans. But the fact that the Neanderthals themselves had, quote, modern human, or they had African, you know, ancestry, means that there were earlier waves, actually. So we know this for a fact. So why can't we see it in modern human genomes? I think there's two options here. I think this is what my consensus, or what I believe will turn out to be consensus. It's actually there. It's just very low levels, just like Neanderthal Denisovan ancestry. But since it's not very diverged, it's really hard to detect, right? So Neanderthal Denisovan ancestry are like, depending on how you estimate it, probably like 3 to 4 times more diverged than this like paleo-modern earlier wave. And so it's not detectable. But I think that there were quote-unquote modern. I think like a term that some geneticists like to use now is stem lineage, because it's the stem to like most of our ancestry in the world. So there's been a lot of stuff that's obviously been going on with Neanderthals, and you've been giving some thought about it. So let's move on to we already talked about Denisovans, but look, we got to talk about Denisovans. They've kind of stolen the Neanderthal thunder a little bit, I believe, since they're they were genomically discovered at the end of 2010, and there's been more and more work, and their ancestry is found all across Asia, basically east of the Indus. There's low levels, like 0.15 to like 0.3 or 0.35 percentage. And then in Southeast Asia, it starts increasing until you get to the Philippines and Papua, where you see some serious proportions. And last I checked, the highest Denisovan fractions were probably actually in the Negrito people, like the Aita, of the Philippines. The issue today is like they're only 30 to 40% Melanesian. I don't know if Melanesian is the right word, but pre-Austronesian. And so their proportions are considerably lower than in Papua. But if you just assume that it's from the Melanesian or pre-Austronesian proportion, it was higher. And that might have been a different Denisovan population, actually, than the signals in the Papuans. So it's a very, very species. I don't want to say speciose, but there's a lot of deep lineages in Denisovans. And I think we talked about this before, but just to reiterate, I think this has to do with ecology. I think it has to do with, during the Pleistocene, there's ecological depth in Asia. You could go southward and retreat. In the northwest of Eurasia, there's the Mediterranean to the south blocking you. There's really, really intense deserts to the south. And I think that the metapopulation dynamics suffered from massive extinctions repeatedly with the proto-Neanderthal population. We see that, it seems, in the genomic record. Whereas with Denisovans, relict population seems to have persisted everywhere and then re-expanded. What do you think about that?
I think, when I was a student and we thought about what were these populations like and how can we understand them, throughout most of the 20th century, people, anthropologists, thought about hunting and gathering peoples historically, ethnographically. They thought, how do we explain ancient people, right? Prehistoric people who lived, thousands and thousands of years ago. They were like, the present is a good model to the past, but we have to find the right people in the present to understand. And hunting and gathering, foraging peoples are the ones that we have today that we can look at group size and group dynamics and try to come to an understanding of what the demography of very, very ancient people might have been like. And I think that the genetics is telling us that that actually is not the case, that today's hunting and gathering people have networks genetically, right, that connect them across very wide regions that are, that are super effective, right? People who today are living at very low population density in terms of, on landscapes that have low carrying capacity are highly buffered with their connections through kinship and through cultural relationships across very large areas. And what the ancient DNA is telling us about Neanderthals and Denisovans, where we have their DNA samples, which is Siberia, is that these populations were not maintaining super distant you know, kin networks, and they were not highly exogamous. We're finding that their kin relations are very close. We're finding, you know, the Chigirskaya paper that came out this year is amazing in terms of documenting the relationships of individuals, kinship relationships between bone fragments in a site, and giving a measure of, okay, what's your long-term local population size and density, right? We're looking at very small populations that had a much, had did not have the strength of long distance networks that recent people have had. And that points to a different kind of interaction between ancient people, Denisovans, Neanderthals, probably ancient Africans as well, and landscapes. I think that people were much more landscape dependent. They lived and succeeded and maintained population growth in areas where they fit into their landscapes really well, where they could use the landscape in their favor, where their technology enabled them to survive and do well in a local area, and that those areas were kind of few and far between. So when we find people in the middle of Siberia, we're not necessarily finding the place that they were really super well suited for all the time, right? Why is it that the mixture between Neanderthals and Denisovans in the middle of Siberia doesn't have this sort of long-term sort of waves that go out from there? It's because this population is always on the edge and probably on balance is shrinking. And it's replenished from relative source populations that are, you know, elsewhere. If you look at Denisovans in that kind of perspective, they're super interesting. Because we've got, I think right now, fairly good evidence that Denisovans are not only in island Southeast Asia, in Sundaland, but also in Wallacea. The mixture in Papua seems to indicate, and the presence of their genetics in the Philippines, right, these deep lineages seem like deep Southeast Asian and maybe Wallacean lineages. These are people who are making it and are succeeding for a long time in places that are kind of, you know, very different from each other. And that to me suggests that we are looking at, you know, what are the Denisovans? I think the Denisovans, the lineages that we're finding that diverged more than 300,000 years ago, you know, by our estimates, this is more different than people in the world are from each other today. Right, we're looking at an adaptive radiation of a human population into maybe local environments, maybe niches that made a difference to their survival and evolution. And when modern humans, after 100,000 years ago, encountered these groups and mixed with them in different places, you know, that must have been a real, you know, sort of, it must have been really different from today. It must have been an encounter that it's difficult for us today to imagine. I think it's really cool, right? Because it brought adaptive variation into our today's populations. And we're, you know, globally, we're the beneficiaries of that. But it does speak to a history that's different from what we imagined in the 1990s, right? This is a history that where humans were tied to ecologies in important ways. And that's pretty cool, right? That gives ecology and environment an importance that is co-equal with culture, I think, in the formation of some of these populations.
Well, yeah, that's intense. So this is actually part of a general trend. Even during the Holocene, you can see a massive, massive crash in pairwise FSTs, in like a reduction in genetic diversity as gene flow really, really cranks up. It's you know, you were talking about humans. So I recently for the Substack, and I'm going to date this recording, but I recently wrote something about Madagascar, and one of the, I don't know if I took the word out, but you know, so the Austronesians that arrived at Madagascar, they terraformed the island. That's the way I think of it. They terraformed it. You see these steppe rice paddies in the highlands that look like they're in Southeast Asia. So they transplanted an ecology, and the local ecology was totally decimated. You know, we know about the elephant bird, but there are these giant sloth lemurs that they obviously, you know, they either killed and ate them, or just as likely, actually, they destroyed their habitat through firing, right? So humans terraform. And what I wonder now, after what you've said, is perhaps the terraforming by our lineage, these are stem humans, the most recent out of Africa, is what distinguishes us. We fire the land, we transform it, we take dominion over the earth. Maybe they were not like that, including our own modern ancestors.
It's a super interesting and provocative hypothesis. We have right now, you know, evidence for sort of landscape fire, you know, this kind of altering the landscape through fire from Malawi, you know, going back to 80 to 100,000 years ago. So we know that within Africa, this goes back to, you know, before the dispersal of modern humans around the world. I'll mention that there's a little bit of data from northern Germany from Neanderthal times that suggests possible landscape fire use. And so I wouldn't rule out that, you know, this kind of knowledge of fire and using fire to rejuvenate the landscape and bring animals back, right, might actually be quite widespread. You know, chimpanzees are, you know, that live in savanna habitats, recognize fire and recognize some resources that are available to them after fires have gone through, right? So that's not necessarily it, but I think that there's something, I mean, maybe more intensive that you're pointing to that might really be important, right? You're taking with you an ecology. If you're a Holocene human moving to a new place, you take an ecology with you. And the question is, how far back does that go? And how would we recognize it if, right, it's not the same scope of this sort of landscape alteration and bringing very exotic seeds, you know, across oceans and stuff, but is more subtle than that. Because there's a lot of evidence. We're getting better at noticing the subtle signs of this. You know, the evidence for ancient open spaces in the Amazon basin, you know, that are, you know, the former large carrying capacity human habitation places. I hate to say that, you know, recognizing giant landscape things that were altered by humans is subtle, right? Because we maybe should have noticed some things before. But we are now more attentive to that kind of ancient evidence. And I wonder, right, could we find the evidence of, you know, of Neanderthals bringing stuff and making their space different? Because I think of them as being, I think that how we started on this is I'm really thinking about Neanderthals and their era of people as having been limited by landscapes. You know, they have deep knowledge of landscapes, using landscapes, but I don't think of them as creating landscapes. And humans do today, clearly. So is that a difference? Is a good question.
I guess like the what you're explaining and what you're asserting, which it sounds about right, actually, from what little I know, is, you know, most human lineages up until the last 100,000 years were shaped by their landscape. And we shape the landscape.
Yeah.
So we flipped the script, so to speak. We changed the narrative. We expanded our own ecology. You know, we underwent a massive range expansion, as they say in, you know, ecological parlance, 50,000, 60,000 years ago. But maybe we didn't actually expand our range. It's like we expanded the range and then we followed the range. That's what you're kind of saying. You know, it's a different way to think of it. It's a different way to think of it. And I think it's very interesting, and it makes you wonder why, like what happened, you know, within this ancient population that underwent this.
It's quite true that where we went into new spaces, where our ancestors and relatives went into new spaces like the Arctic, we did so. I mean, you didn't necessarily change the external ecology, but you created an internal ecology, right? You created the ability through technology and clothing and control of fire and structures, right? You create the ecology that enables us to surpass those places. And maybe that's a way of looking at it. We can recognize when we're shaping our environments. It's just that we start by creating a bubble around ourselves and carrying our environment with us.
Yeah. I totally think that's a good way to a bubble. Yeah. And sometimes the bubble is in other animal furs and whatnot, right? I mean, that's pretty straightforward. So I want to ask you just about the other stuff that I don't know too much about, but I've read the preprint and, you know, I follow Chris Stringer and others who are very active on social media. Chris Stringer has been on this podcast before. Maybe I'll get him on later, but you know, these Luzon hominins, like what's going on in Southeast Asia? So here's a hypothesis that I proposed. Southeast Asia is it's the second home of the great apes. There are orangutans there. Like gibbons are lesser apes, right? But it seems quite. I hesitate to use the word species because I'm weird about species when it comes to Homo. But let's just say species. But you know, you have hobbits, you have Luzon. You probably have several types of Denisovans at minimum. If the late erectus are not erectus, they're a very unique type of Denisovan.
Yeah.
Probably, I do believe there are some archaeological sites that are disputed, but I do think that our modern human ancestors were there. Related to our modern human ancestors, I think there was a Neo-African lineage, and that Neo-African lineage is the donor. To the ancestor you see in the Altai Neanderthal, that's quite clearly related to modern human beings, right? And these were all replaced, like about replaced or assimilated 60,000 years ago. So my hypothesis: Southeast Asia is like this because it's the most ecologically during the Ice Age, the most ecologically like Africa, like with Sunda Land and the savanna, the woodland, and all these things. What do you think about that?
I think that's a good model, right? I think the missing data that we have is from South Asia. Because that's another area, that, and it has to be a bridge between Africa and Southeast Asia, right? And it also, right, in terms of climate and in terms of landscapes, you know, is again one of these Gondwana fragments that still carries that sort of landscape similarity, and we just have very little fossil information and no genetic information, you know, that informs us about that. I think, you know, Southeast Asia is right now a center of tremendous interest from those of us who are interested in this deep past. And, you know, we think about it a lot. There are these two, I think, converging elements of interest, right? One is that we're learning more about the diversity on continental Asia and including, right, the islands that were, you know, formerly connected to continental Asia. And also there's Wallacea. And you've got, you know, the Philippines and Sulawesi and Flores that have habitation by hominins, you know, in deep time. There are a couple of things that are, for me, facts that are that I keep in my mind as being like, okay, whatever explanation we have, it has to consider that there are these facts. One of those is that habitation on Flores and on Luzon begins before 900,000 years ago. So you've got water transport that is effective enough in this region to allow the colonization of basically, you know, every island that is in practice by somebody 900,000 years ago. That's not Denisovans. That's something erectus or earlier. So I keep that in my mind. The other thing I keep in my mind is that the early erectus fossils actually do share features with the late erectus fossils. And so whatever, you know, populations you want to connect them with genetically, you either have to have some kind of continuity to account for these, you know, morphological similarities, which are real, or you've got to have the, you know, convergent evolution of the morphological similarities. And we just don't, in what we know about Denisovans, have strong evidence for a deep time component of their ancestry in Southeast Asia. Now, it could be that the deep time component that you know, people have maybe seen in the Siberian Denisova genome is an echo of this, that it's like, okay, yeah, this is, and we just haven't invented sophisticated enough ways of looking at today's genomes to siphon out those multiple layers. That's totally possible. But whatever's the case, it is on the table, I think, that the Denisovans that we are understanding today as a sister group of Neanderthals, we have to integrate into a fossil picture where the fossils that we have in Southeast Asia are fossils, you know, before 100,000 years ago, are fossils that appear to have a deep time component.
Yeah.
A deep time more than a million years ago, you know, so that's there. I think on the score of, was there a pre-modern dispersal, right? We talk about the dispersal of modern humans. Most geneticists today are thinking 70,000 to 100,000 years ago, some small human population of African origin disperses throughout Eurasia and then ultimately the rest of the world. I think it's very credible. I mean, we know we've got fossils like the Mislia cave maxilla from Israel. It's more than 160,000 years old. The Apodema II fossil from Greece that is more than 160,000 years old, that morphologically resemble African populations to the extent that, you know, they could be early, you know, sort of pre-modern dispersal migrants. If you've got that, there's no reason to think that they can't be in South China, which is where, you know, a couple of sites, people suggest that this is a very early African-like modern dispersing group. That is to say that these groups are sparse enough, and when they get going, they might go for some distance and maintain a coherence genetically, morphologically, that you notice. And we may be looking at a world where groups are coexisting across really wide, across much of Eurasia, that are quite genetically diverse and more genetically diverse than today's groups by far, and exist and flow and ultimately maybe don't have a huge influence on later populations. You know, if that's the world of the past, it does, it invites for us the opportunity to say, we don't have to connect every gene with everybody.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or every fossil with everybody, right? It is very much like Rebecca Kahn used to say in the 80s, we know that our genes have ancestors, but we don't know that your fossils have descendants. And that, you know, is a reality of what we work with.
Oh, wow. So we have a student of Milford Wolpoff quoting Rebecca Kahn for the paleo nerds out there. I think people are chuckling out there. They should be, if you don't understand what I'm saying, you know, just, I don't know, just Wikipedia Wolpoff and Milford Wolpoff and Rebecca Kahn out of, you know, just you guys will know. So, you know, it's as I'm recording, it's near the year end of 2022. Just tell the listener, hopefully I try to keep these podcasts evergreen, but, you know, I just want to be candid here because I want to look into the future. What are you looking forward to, John? I want to know, I want your crystal ball because, you know, I feel like the last couple of years, you know, I've been busy with things, but I've kind of taken my ball off the paleo, you know, more deep time human evolution for more like recent population structure stuff, you know? And I still think I saw a paper in PLOS Genetics, I think, that just came out about functional adaptation of Denisovan ancestry in Melanesia. There's still stuff going out there. And I give a shout out to you and Greg Cochran for, you know, popularizing the idea of functional adaptations introgressing. In I think 2006 was your paper on that topic.
Yeah.
Into modern lineages, you guys were totally validated on that. So the stuff is still happening. So what are you looking forward to in the coming year?
We are, you know, there's a couple of things on the near horizon that, you know, you don't have to be, you know, sort of clairvoyant to know are going to be important. One of those is proteins. We are on the verge of having proteomic evidence, you know, from dental enamel and possibly from dentin and bone from almost all of the human fossil record. Right. I will not be surprised if we have this for every fossil hominin. Certainly, we will have this for all fossil hominins in the last 3 million years. And that will be unfolding, right? It's not going to happen instantaneously, but that's going to unfold over the next several years. And now protein data is sparse. It is very low information content compared to DNA.
A lot less variation than DNA for the listener, because the protein is translated from the DNA, and the DNA is much more variable, the underlying DNA, much more degenerate.
Yeah.
Go on, John.
So there are very few protein differences between in these proteins, right? Enamel proteins, collagen, right? Between humans and Neanderthals and Denisovans, for instance. But as we go to deeper time, we're going to have protein data, and it's going to, I think, we have the potential of looking at the phylogeny of hominins in a really different way. I will not be surprised if we have a different way of looking at relationships in deep time, you know, 10 years from now than we do now. We're gonna show that morphology actually was not that helpful for many of these.
Whoa! Especially you're a morphology, you know, skulls and whatnot guy. So you say that is heresy, sir.
Yeah. Well, look, I have to look at reality. I really, you know, based on morphology, believe the line that if anybody is going to have more Neanderthal DNA, it's going to be Europeans, and Cro-Magnons are the ancestors of today's European people. And right, morphology told us all those things that we know today are totally wrong.
I see.
So
if the evidence changes, your views have to change. That's called science.
Yeah, exactly. So that's on the horizon, right? And it's happening, right? That research is being done, right?
We have
from Homo antecessor. We're going to have it from almost everything.
Yeah. So just a quick question. I know that there was some Greenland ecological DNA that was like a couple of million years old, but really, usually DNA can't get much more than a couple of 100,000 years old. There's some freak conditions, like the Spanish site, you're talking about 400 some thousand years. And there was a horse from the Tamir Peninsula in northern Siberia that was 900K, right? Yep, so DNA is a complex macromolecule. It's obviously pretty robust if it lasts hundreds of thousands of years. But proteins, just to be clear for the listener, are much more robust, at least the collagen proteins. And so they're going to push it much further. Like, what are you hearing on the street, you know, on the paleo street, so to speak? How many millions of years are you guys going to get?
People are talking about Miocene. So, you know, we may be looking at 20 million years.
What the? I mean, I'm not going to swear because it's a family podcast, but that's mind blowing.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm like shocked.
There's real potential there. We are also, one of the really cool things that's emerging is this high resolution through mass spectrometry, rare element and rare isotope sampling. And the useful thing there is with teeth. If you take a section of a tooth and it has growth increments, right? You can actually track days of growth in a tooth. And today, it is possible with really advanced probing and mass spectrometry to measure elemental abundances in little, like a dot matrix across a tooth surface, and get exposures and things like, it's a great paper by Tanya Smith and her collaborators this year that looked at a Miocene ape sample and got rainfall and through oxygen isotopes, periods of big rainfall during the development of these individuals' lives, right? From 18 million years ago. So we are able to reconstruct, I think, the potential is there to put individuals into their local environment and see the things that made a difference in their lives in a way that was not imaginable, right? And that science is happening now, right? This is we do this now. So it's just a matter of putting into place the right research questions and the right collaborations to answer really cool questions about things in the past.
Yeah, you know, obviously on this podcast and from my viewpoint, like I think about DNA a lot, think about ancient DNA a lot. But what you're highlighting and surfacing for us is, you know, archaeology and paleoanthropology have many more biophysical tools, biophysical markers, biophysical indicators, from isotope analysis to proteins and all these other tools. And the whole field is actually expanding. DNA is just, you know, I mean, maybe it's like the charmed child in some ways, gets a little preferential treatment. There's a lot. Look, there's a lot of there's a lot of information in there, and it's a common currency to understand. We can understand it in a very easy way. It's digital, whereas with isotopes and some of these others, you know, requires a little bit more work. But still, it's real information, and you know, going millions of years, tens of millions of years into the past. Whoa, can you believe if you told me that when, you know, I actually went back, John, and I looked at some of our blogging heads, and boy, we were younger. 2009, you know, if you had like told us, if like, you know, the ghost of Christmas future came back and is like, you know, Dr. Hawks, Razib Khan, you will be talking about proteomics, protein analysis, 20 million years into the, we would just be like, what? You know, like, we would both like just be like frozen in shock. Yeah. I mean, we were barely on the, you know, they were still doing like mammoth and cave bear DNA, and yeah, we knew that they were going to go to Neanderthals and stuff, but now we have thousands of ancient DNA remains, and now we're talking tens of millions of years. It's like, we're so far beyond.
The ancient DNA has transformed so much, right? This, you know, the fact early this year, early in 2022, you know, this paper describing the, you know, there's DNA in sediment, right? So you just sample a sediment from a cave and there's DNA in it. And really amazing paper that actually looked at the sediment at very high resolution to see how is the DNA being preserved in this? And in sediment from Denisova cave, there are very, very tiny flakes of bone that are decomposing into the site and very, very tiny flakes of coprolite. And this is where the DNA is coming from. And so you've got the potential within sites to have a micro scale record of DNA. They've already got fine scale sampling across two faces of sediment profiles in Denisova with a matrix of DNA sampling to show the presence of Neanderthals and Denisovans in sediment, along with every other creature that has mitochondrial sequence in it. So you sort of, it's like a fingerprint of every creature that left anything in the site. And, you know, when I think of the way that some sites were dug 50 years ago and the information that was sort of left in a pile by the stream where they shook the stone tools out of it. You know, the fact that we today are looking at trace evidence of proteins on the edges of stone tools, know what animal they were cutting.
Yeah. Well, basically, these ancient foragers, these hunter-gatherers, and these ancient serial killers thought that they could get away with it, but it turns out we have the DNA.
There you go.
We know exactly what they did, and yes. The FBI is going to be knocking at their cave hut or whatever. I don't know.
You thought you were going to let your kid poop in the cave and no one would ever know. Well, guess what? We're here.
Well, I mean, cave poop is cave poop is how was the Oregon? I forget which one is like
the Paisley Caves. Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah. It's an amazing site. Yeah,
and that's how they figured out humans were there. I mean, there's mitochondrial DNA they got out of it, and the dates and stuff like that. So, like, poop is precious, not just for fertilizer, but also for archaeology. There's all sorts of information you could get out of it. Well. On that incredible note, I think we should close it out here, John, for this year. I hope we don't go another 2 years. I have a feeling you and Lee are going to be visible on my social media feeds a lot next year. And, you know, we will discover a lot of new things. I mean, I think, you know, you can only say what you can say, but I'm getting the sense that there's a lot of stuff going on, John.
we have some things that I have trouble believing. And that is, you know, that's sort of been the case from the beginning. But I got to tell you that this site is just drawing us in and it's amazing. So that's coming. We've got, we've got a Netflix show that's going to be coming out next year that covers the research that we're doing this year.
You guys are stars.
Yeah. It's pretty cool stuff. I'm obviously writing about this, johnhawks.net, so people can follow. This is going to be a big year, 2023.
And I will give it, give this podcast, this show an appropriate title. Last time I titled it John Hawks a Life because we talked about your intellectual life, but people were freaking out that it was an open. They were like messaging you. They're like, dude, you freak me out. You need to change the title. So I changed the title. Luckily I had fewer than 10% of the mailing list that I do now. So, this is what I need to do, the good titles I've learned. But it was great talking to you, John. It's always a pleasure. I learned a lot. I know the audience learned a lot, and we're going to be learning a lot from you guys in 2023, right?
Awesome.
All right.
This podcast for kids. Favorite.